Welcome back, everybody, to the League of Legends World Championship, where we're about to jump into Game 4 between the KU Tigers and KT. Well, as we see KT huddling there, because it looked after that first game like it would be a 2, maybe 3-0 going that way, and then KT just completely fell apart in some parts of the game.
I think KT's making it a little bit too hard for themselves in the pick and ban phase. They pick these compositions with very small windows where they have to execute perfectly, otherwise the game kind of runs out for them. We see great scaling from KU Tigers in every single game. The Fiora always getting out of control and like no response for KT at any point. And so just these super small windows they have to be able to execute properly for, and they're not doing it.
Yeah, we look just at the curve of these compositions, and KT's comp last game only really works 15 to 25 minutes, but they lose early, they lose late, and they really have to hit that mid-game window. But it's so hard. If you play Malphite and Lu, both bringing utility to the table, you need to fix that with a hyper carry. You need to sort of a Jinx in there, maybe a Tristana, something that can really carry the game. Kalista doesn't have the time. The damage is not front-loaded. There's no resets anywhere. So the only fights you're really going to win realistically is those where you CC all three of the carries.
We don't know what shenanigans are happening behind
us. Probably some cheeky now.
But to go on that point, one big thing we were looking at and we looked at last time as well was the top lane matchup. And that Fiora, pick it away or ban it. You can't deal with it.
So last time KT were on blue side, which will be here in game 4 now.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, KU Tigers were on blue side in game 4. We had a situation where KT could have picked away Fiora for themselves. They took away the Gragas instead, even though Elise was already picked. And they're like, why do you have to take a jungler here? Just take the Fiora for yourself. You should be able to play it up in the top lane. It shouldn't be that big of a problem. If it is, you ban it. I mean, it's that simple. If you cannot play it yourself and execute it, you have to ban their way. Because time and time again, you pick a champion that's going to get outskilled. It was Renekton. Malphite as well. Yes, he can stack armor, but it will always be a split-pushing battle that Fiora is going to win. And you have no answer because KT right now are not able to properly group up and execute the comps they're playing.
Yeah, but on the other hand, before we jump back to the casters, the KU Tigers as well, just showing in better form and choosing the comps that work for them.
More importantly, they're adapting in the game, so they're learning from their mistakes. If we go to game 2, they weren't really playing to their strengths. Suddenly, they start sieging properly, chaining CC, placing the right members in the right places on the map. They start winning the game. Game 3, they lose one fight where all of their three carries get AoE CC'd. They learn from that and arrow the remaining parts of the fight, he just went untouched overall and started carrying these fights.
Definitely. All right.
It's too easy for KU Tigers, honestly, in these late game fights. And KT, I was expecting so much more from this team. Also, when it comes to this whole vision control, they're not showing it in game at all. It just falls apart.
Definitely.
And I meant pre.
Well, we'll see what happens. I still think it has a lot of potential of going all the way to game 5. So let's dive into game 4 with our marvelous casters.
Wow. Wow, thanks, Shox. That was so nice.
Marvelous.
We are marvelous, aren't we?
I'm the most marvelous.
No, you're not. Come on. Oh, well, we can be marvelous together. Why do you always have to take all the marvelousness?
I'm sorry. Just right. I'm like a Marvel magnet, actually. Just
has he told you about his continental ties, Dylan?
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah. This guy is like, he's got his continental ties. All right, that's, I suppose marvelous would be the word for it. So 4 games is going to be what it's going to be after this game. Well, okay, anyway. Yeah. 4...
Four is the number.
This is like KT when they decided to fight around Dragon last game.
I feel less marvelous
now.
KT versus KU game 4. There we go. Right in the picks and bans. And we're not so marvelous after all. Azir banned away right away by the KU Tigers. Tom Kench for KT. But like the analysts were saying, what do you do about that Fiora? If you are KT, do you ban it away? Do you try to pick it? Something needs to be done here. Mordekaiser banned on the blue side. Gangplank, Fiora's still up.
Yeah, so we do see the rehash from KU of the same bans and first pick that we saw in game 2 of this series. And KT here, they have left up the Darius this time, which is the change in the bans.
Yep. Yeah, that's true. So now it will kind of be the make or break point. They have been able to win the matchup when they had Darius on their side, so I actually think they're okay if somebody still doesn't want to play Fiora, and they could push the make or break point to the next game of whether or not somebody would have to play Fiora. He should be able to do it. It's just a question of whether KT wants to run a squishier top lane champion like Fiora and play into that strategy.
They had a bit of a struggle with it in game 1, but we will see. Don't think it's going to be the Blitzcrank pick for KT. Be fun to see. But I think Darius Shen is quite reasonable, and that is what they're going to lock in. So, KU Tigers weren't able to win against that Darius in game 1 with the Fiora. Will they chance it here in game 4?
You know, one thing about KT, if we look back to how they were doing in the group stage, one thing that they did execute very successfully was many, many globals.
Yes.
In their second game against Origin. So they may try to go back to that strategy where they play the Shen themselves. Mm-hmm. And then try and use that advantage in the late game.
Very true. There's a Fiora hovered over by the Ku Tigers right now.
I believe that team composition had an Azir in it, which is banned, but they can still get something similar if Nagne is willing to play Victor in the mid lane. I think Victor would actually be a spectacular takeaway for Nagne right now. But
Nagne's never been the best Victor player.
Yeah,
that's one of the issues. There could be a Twisted Fate or something like that coming in too, depending on what Ku wants to blind pick here. They may go ahead and just take away the Ashe.
Wow, you know, when we've seen that in the past between these two teams, Prey just switches right over to Kog'Maw, right over to some other hyper carry.
We did say KT was going to have to make a pretty big change in pick ban strategy because it felt like they came on the short side of team comps all three games.
Yeah.
I actually agree here with not taking the Ashe. When the Alistar is already on the table and he can just body block that, use the Unbreakable Will, it does make the picks a lot less attractive, and instead they've got a lot of peel now. The Gragas and Shen combination to go with the Jinx.
Yeah, I think the Jinx, I would have wanted to see the Jinx right here. Please do the Jinx.
Jinx, there it is. And Gragas for score as well.
Yeah, specifically because they have a very strong tank line and they have a lot of CC for when Smeb tries to initiate through the flank. I want to see the resetting potential. There's a reason Jinx has been such a highly contested pick throughout Worlds. It's a very team fight focused meta right now. And a lot of squishy targets that can get that are very susceptible to Jinx AoE rockets. I like the pick.
You know, we could see something like, I guess not Kalista Kennen because Alistar's already been taken by Ku, but we could see Ashe, and there's that Victor. Wow, are the Ku Tigers going to try to win one with Draven? I doubt it. Prey.
I still have nightmares of the Praven, and not in the way that it strikes fear into my heart. But
just the way that it should strike fear into the Ku fans' heart. Caitlyn seems reasonable, though.
Yeah, may go into this matchup again. We've seen it play out once already.
It's an enormous amount of poke between Ace in the Hole and a long-range Victor laser.
Good siege.
Really takes a big chunk out of Jinx.
Ku Tigers have set up an excellent pick and 4-1 split comp again, and that's really what they've been doing very well so far this series. Just take the 4-1 split. Smeb has just consistently delivered on this Fiora, and if you're not going to take it away with him, he's just going to grab it and continue to run it until someone figures out how to stop him.
Yeah, this game, I will say there are better answers on the side of KT. Darius has shown that he can be an answer to Fiora in the split push game. Also, there's not as much to guard against an initiation when Ku tries to set up a four-man siege. No Event Horizon. The Gragas can initiate very well for KT. They can put the Shen on his back for an even larger initiation. And Victor could end up being fairly vulnerable.
Well, also, in case there are all of those all-ins, the Shen support able to come and help out now with the Darius Fiora duels in a lot better of a manner. We could see this teleport LeBlanc coming through, of course.
Yeah.
But the Orianna looking for the team fights.
I like the Orianna. I mean, when with the champions like Alistar, like Fiora, when everybody
comes in.
But actually, Cassiopeia locked in for Nagne.
I actually like the pick here. I know it sounds weird, but this has been one of Nagne's best champions. In the last best of five, Ku was very insistent on banning the Cassiopeia. It's been one of his best champions. And when we consider synergy with Gragas, Gragas is a champion that will give you a single target that you can really follow up on. Very high damage, and now there are three high damage sources on this team that can really carve people up.
And funnily enough, since that series they played in the playoffs, Victor has received nerfs and Cassiopeia has remained untouched. So even though the game has changed around the Cassiopeia, it's still very viable in this head-to-head matchup. And Nagne, they make a big change, but they go back to a pick.
You know, another benefit that champion brings too is, again, when the Fiora jumps in, when the Elise, when the Alistar get in your face, you just ult them. You just ult, you freeze them in place, you turn the team fight around. I think that's exactly what they're going to be looking for Nagne to do this game. A lot really rests on Nagne's Cassiopeia ults, and also someday up in that top lane.
Yeah, I think as a counterpick to the Fiora in the team fights, this should be really interesting because we have to ask ourselves, what was happening in these last games? A lot of it was Fiora getting on top of Arrow, in that game three.
Yeah.
Well, that's going to be a hell of a lot harder with the Petrifying Gaze. Smeb is going to have to be very fast to turn his back.
I would agree. Well, perhaps one last time, guys, let us know who you think you're going to see in the semifinals. Hashtag KooWin if you think they're going to close it out right here, right now, or hashtag KTWin at LOL Esports if you think KT Rolster can tie things up and force that game five as we move into Summoner's Rift. See if this game four, will be our last game of the day. I still think it could go to distance. KT, one game one with this Darius pick. Can they do it again when it matters most?
Well, specifically the changes KT has made to their team composition. This composition is better suited for the way KOO Tigers is winning.
True.
Nagne showing some of his flexibility. That is now the 25th unique mid lane champion we've seen at Worlds.
Holy cow.
Wow. So many unique champions at Worlds this year. And we're only in the quarterfinals now.
If you want to be a mid laner, learn 25 specific new champions to have the full pool. Unreal.
Wow. It's like learning to play Tekken suddenly. Like a billion different characters.
Yeah, so all time, 10 games for Nagne on Cassiopeia. He is 7-3.
Respectable. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, he's been a good Cassiopeia player, and off Peekaboo tries to go in for the taunt on a prey, takes a little bit of damage in response, but they're doing a good amount to Gorilla as well. Gorilla just dropping a ward on his way out. And KT going for a bit of a late invade into the jungle. We'll see what they decide to do. Just a ward over the wall into the red buff pit to keep an eye on where Hojin might be going.
And they will just back right out after that, so. One ward over in red, so we'll see if this affects the decision from the KOO Tigers as to where they're going to be pathing early. Looks like they are fainting up towards the top side, and we are going to be heading for standard lanes once again.
Yeah, now, Nagne was originally known as an assassin player in that mid lane. Did have a little bit of trouble adapting to more of the control mage types, but over the course of 2015 especially, I feel like we've seen Nagne really come into his own as a more well-rounded mid laner.
Yeah, absolutely. And champion pool really hasn't been an issue for these guys this year, especially since assassins, generally speaking, this year haven't been as popular.
Did you see Prey throw that Peacemaker over the wall there? He must have a timing for when the Gromp normally goes down and tried to steal it, but was not being done by KT this time. And he's going to miss on a little bit of XP because of it. Kind of a cool idea, though.
Nice thought. A lot of times you'll see the support going in to try and harass. Why not send the AD carry for an attempted steal? Caitlyn would be a champion who'd be able to do that, but...
Yeah, you can do it without too much danger if you do it like way back there with the tilt over Peacemaker. Oh, taunt on a prey.
Really not a favorable trade.
Yeah, a little bit over-aggressive for Peekaboo.
Yeah, he taunted into five minions there.
Yeah. Does not help.
Okay, you can just throw swords to make it up. You know, when Dylan and I cosplayed as Shen, we realized how difficult it is to actually unsheathe Shen swords from
that. Nearly impossible.
You actually can't do that.
You need like really a triple jointed arm. Yeah, you need like an extra elbow to do what Shen does.
I mean, you'd really have to be a ninja in order to do that.
I don't know, do you just have two elbows on each arm?
It's actually a prerequisite.
Is it?
Yeah.
No wonder you don't see him very often anymore. Who knew? Well, Smeb could be in a bit of trouble here. Might
he
have
to
burn that flash.
The flash body slam.
Okay, there we go. And he did. Threatened enough that Smeb used that summoner to get away.
All right, but Hojin may have another angle into the enemy jungle as a result of that.
Definitely. Going to go right over and take that blue buff.
Yeah, this is definitely going to come. The level 2 gank is going to come with a price here. Hojin on top of that blue. And because... So, KT had a ward at that red buff, so they knew what side of the jungle KOO started on, so they consciously made this decision. They knew that Hojin should be over on that side of the map at that given time, so it's actually a pretty high price to pay. Mm-hmm. Hojin coming ahead in the jungle.
And now depending on how greedy Hojin wants to be, he can push score off of his wolves as well if he waits.
Tons of pings going down.
Yeah, smart by score there to use his smite.
Yeah.
On the wolf so he can get the scouting. Otherwise, that would have been Hojin coming in towards the back end of that camp.
Yeah, meanwhile, they're going to try to make a play onto Nagne here in the mid lane, but Nagne already playing to the safer side of the lane. He can get back to his turret or his jungle if he needs to. And so, KOO is going to quickly give that one up.
They're really going to be waiting for the scaling here. Of course, you are going to get that tier, the Goddess on Cassiopeia, so your power early, not going to be aggressive. Nice trade.
Yeah, no kidding. Prey taunted, and the Flame Chopper's thrown down by Arrow immediately to set up that longer CC chain. Pretty good.
TB already used by Sunday in the top side. And through, and we'll see Something similar from Smeb as he recalls with that wave very close to his turret. Was hoping for perhaps a little bit of a freeze there, and he may get it as he TP's right back in.
Smeb doing his best to survive in this lane. Darius definitely having some of the early advantages. There's the gank.
Ultrise onto Peekaboo, and Peekaboo's going to flash and get shoved the wrong direction. Not bad at all. Peekaboo escapes.
I also want to call that really unlucky from Gorilla. When he flashed Pulverize, Peekaboo was on the very edge of the brush. So when he went to headbutt him backwards, he lost vision, and that allowed Peekaboo to then flash afterwards. So that's just the nature of the game sometimes.
Well, flash for flash. And I mean, they did burn that exhaust as well during that engage. So all in all, it was 1-for-2 in favor of Ku Tigers. And getting a lot of damage onto the turret, too.
They are backed up right now. This Caitlyn matchup going much better this time around for Prey so far. Nice job denying some of the CS and getting some traps down right next to the turret, making it even harder to pick up the farm.
Pretty much. Hojin just farming for the moment anyway.
Even when Nagme's recall timing is going to be, remember that he does have the teleport, so he can come back to lane. He definitely has enough money for the tier at the moment, but isn't going to start stacking it up just yet.
Yeah, wants to push Kuro in a little bit more, it looks like.
Yeah, this is a really good job early by Nagne, honestly. I feel like Cassiopeia has a bit of ramp-up time, but he's been able to push Kuro in very successfully. This is why Ku Tigers was so scared of the Cassiopeia in the playoffs in the LCK.
I don't think they expected it to come out against it. I know I certainly didn't.
Yeah, well, I mean, we were even talking about it. It's just not a champion that we see in the meta very often these days, or really at all. So KT and Nagne kind of going back to an old standard when they really need to keep themselves alive at Worlds.
You see how conservative Someday's playing right now. He doesn't want to get ganked. He understands that Nagne really wants to press the advantage in the mid lane and is already pushing forward on the map, and so doesn't want to open up any kind of opportunities for Ku while the jungler is in the bottom side.
Well, the stats pretty similar for these two top laners between Smeb's Fiora and Someday's Darius.
Been a pretty reliable pick.
Yep. Uh-oh. Oh boy. Prey.
Danger down here.
Yeah, teleport coming down just to confirm it. Prey on top of those flame choppers. Yet again, gonna flash away. Turret hits doing a lot of damage to Peekaboo. Peekaboo nearly goes down. First blood goes to Peekaboo. And he makes it out. He must have had like 10 health there. Oh, no, revenge from the bloodthirsty support. Gorilla wants a kill too, trying to take down Peekaboo, but can Peekaboo get that taunt off before Gorilla catches him?
Victor's on the way too.
That's right, the mid laner's coming down, and Ku Tigers trying to collapse down here in bot lane. Kuro doing a lot of damage to Nagne. Flame chompers are dodged. Nagne in a lot of trouble, has no summoners, and he's gonna get taken out. Kill goes to Kuro. 1-for-1 in the end, but that's a kill on the mid laner for Ku, which makes it a bit better. And Peekaboo taking that first blood.
Yeah, Peekaboo only got out with a sliver of health, too. That was an overly aggressive dive that I think was appropriately punished by the Ku Tigers. Prey had his flash, and Nagne did not teleport in a position in which he could combo after the flash. He ends up burning 4 summoner spells just to get that initial kill, and it's ridiculous KT didn't get punished harder for that.
Yeah, and also just trying to start that play, Arrow had not been back to shop yet, so assuming you're going to burn somebody down with just a Doran's Blade, and we also look at the buy from Nagne before the TP, Tyr and Negatron Cloak? That's not a smart dive to make. You are not itemized to do that efficiently.
Yeah, well, Someday pulls Smeb in. That apprehend. Can't quite catch him at the Q, though. Close call for Smeb. And Nagne back to lane. Well, not a ton of damage. Oh, there we go. A dive onto Someday. Smeb pops that ultimate score there to try to protect his top laner.
Can they turn it?
Smeb in a bit of trouble. They can. Someday with the kill there. Still low health. Nice explosive cast from Score. Hojin sent running, and he's going to get taken out by KT.
And this,
2 kills.
This
KT.
Isn't the first time we've seen Someday get an edge in the top lane. The question will be whether he can play smart enough to hold this one. This time, though, it was Hojin who flashed in for the initiation, and they didn't have the burst to take down Someday, allowing Score to come in for a nice counter gank. Look at the CS discrepancy even before anything else in that fight. Again, Score has outpassed Hojin in the early jungle, and when he found the 2v2, had the superiority.
Yeah, and especially because he had that ult by the time the fight began, too. So really doing a nice job. You see Hojin right here. They think they caught him out. Flash Cocoon immediately. There's the grand challenge coming down. Someday going to path back to Score. And then Smeb out of mana too.
Yeah,
there's a heal coming through, and Score just keeps Hojin off from getting the return kill with that ultimate hitting 6.
Smeb was pretty low from the initial trading in that lane. So that makes that a much riskier ult than you would first assume if you can stun the Darius from the Fog of War.
And here's
well
something,
punished.
Here's something to really watch too. When Ku Tigers get rattled, Hojin starts to over-prioritize ganking in top lane. That could have been the start of that. We're going to have to really watch that closely to see if there's starting to be a bit of a mental breakdown for the Ku Tigers already in game four.
I don't think they were that worried, especially because they did do such a good job of turning around the teleport gank in the bottom side.
You think so?
Yeah.
Oh, there we go.
Nice taunt
on the Prey. Yeah, Prey stuck in place for a long time. Peekaboo taking a bit of damage himself too. Ends up being a decent trade for KT. Those AoE rockets doing a lot of damage to the bot lane from Ku.
Yeah, they had to back off though. Gorilla was sick, so have that unbreakable will. Should they follow up, Peekaboo still only level 5 and not really going to be as useful in terms of ultimates in a 2v2 fight.
Yeah.
So nice, they got a good trade. Just take it, walk away.
I'm actually very surprised Peekaboo's been able to land so many taunts onto Prey. 650 range, 80 carry with a 90 caliber net that can get him out of range.
It is kind of surprising, isn't it?
Especially with the danger of the chain CC from the Flame Chompers, that should be one of Prey's top priorities, is to not get taunted by the Shen.
It's a bit odd.
But Peekaboo's positioned well and used the Fog of War, and Prey has not wanted to net away defensively.
Well, Peekaboo able to protect his pink ward for the moment. Keep the Gorilla from taking that one out, but now the lane is going to get pushed in Ku's favor. At least it was for the second anyway there.
It is so weird to see a series between two Korean teams where support Shen has become such a priority pick.
This has
never happened before.
We have not seen support Shen in Korea this year until Worlds. We didn't see it in Korea at all. Only here.
Welcome to Worlds.
I guess. Well.
KT is in a really, really, really strong position this game. Anagne, despite the poor teleport bottom lane, is farming up well, stacking his tier, not getting punished. Hojin, yet to complete his jungle item, where his score has been sitting on Cinderhulk for quite some time. And Arrow's Jinx is farming up completely fine against Caitlyn. Pretty much everything KT needed to go right in the early game has gone right.
And Someday too, what a difference in his play this game after he got those kills. You can see he called score up just to protect him in the lane for a counter gank in case he was ganked. As soon as he backs off, they push the wave into the turret. Someday walks into the river to ward. So they are taking many more precautions at conserving their top lane advantage in this game compared to the last couple.
Yeah, very true. KT with the pressure on the bot lane now. Hojin's there to try to help out. He is recalling at the moment, though. CS fairly even in mid between Kuro and Nagne at the moment.
Kuro's actually done a nice job catching up. He was pretty far behind there for a while.
He has.
And he has rebounded in that lane, but Someday still a bit of a problem, of course, finishing that phage early, so he does have that item advantage, and he's starting to run away with it in terms of farm as well.
Well, here comes Score. They're going to try to take away the blue buff, and it doesn't look like Ku is in a position to stop them at this point. We'll see. He may just want to dive up in top here. Someday, Smeb trying to bait him in, but Someday not quite going under turret yet.
I like Smeb using his riposte so early to block the decimate, so it's never even a threat to get 5 stacked for the ultimate. Also, Score doesn't realize he was spotted by a ward while going for deep wards. And I have to be very careful here, since Gorilla did recall and head up that way to begin with.
Well, Nagne's gone. He does have TP if he wants to go for it. Hojin just going to go ahead and ward this up. Find that.
Nope.
Score is already there.
Coming in. And, oh, who got it? Hojin. Able to take it for Ku. Didn't get on the mid laner, but at least they kept it away from KT.
I mean, that execute damage in spider form, you do just have a nice amount of burst there for Elise.
Yep. It's something anyway. Ooh, Ace in the Hole already doing a decent amount of damage with that BF sword for Prey.
I like the early Ace in the Hole just for harassing lane from Caitlyn.
Yeah, why not?
Especially when the support is gone, they have to wait so the Peekaboo can't block it. But that was...
It's a low cooldown, it does a lot of damage, and when your team is trying to push things up to take control around Dragon, you might as well use it.
Nice job by Ku on the vision clear there. Very safe, considering they have the pink ward there, and they waited for 3 people before they cleared out enemy pink up towards that side, so they weren't going to get surprised by anything.
Yeah.
We're more likely to see the 3-lane push here from KT than we ever have been. Already an upgraded warding trinket by Nagne.
Oh boy, Gorilla's going to take a lot of damage. May have to burn that ult. He does. And that's a pretty crucial ult to not have available when you're going in for Dragon. Never mind.
Here we go. Every teleport.
May have an opportunity as teleports come in. KT scaring Ku away. Hojin taken out. And KT continues to pull a little bit farther ahead every time these two teams crash into each other here in game four.
So Someday actually ended up canceling this teleport. Kuro still has his with that. But yeah, Hojin getting punished there for the squishy Runeclave Elise.
Well, Someday able to get that top lane turret too by canceling the teleport, so they still certainly got a lot of value out of that.
Yeah, there's not really a way to Ku can go ahead and do this dragon.
Yeah.
At this juncture either, of course, with the jungler down, but KT falls back to safety. Just gonna keep on split pushing, and they have so many wards in that bottom side river right now. Oh boy!
Oh boy, Prey taunted right after the explosive cast. Beautiful play by KT Rolster. Smeb on the run, turns around with her pos. Gorilla with the engage. Can Kuro do enough damage to turn this one around? He's gonna throw the Chaos Storm down onto Scorb, but with Nogne entering the fight, flash ult, he's gonna get the slow on Gorilla and Smeb. Kuro still trying to get something done for Ku. He'll get one kill as Peekaboo gets a bit too close. Arrow grabs one in response, though.
Peekaboo did not need to
come
back into
Kuro's
that fight.
Oh, Kuro's not done yet. Nogne playing it dangerously. Oh, or is he? Another kill for KT and Nogne.
I think that was a home run attempt for Kuro right there.
Yeah, he
because
tried.
They're losing so much off of that fight. KT was supposed to be on the offensive, but Scores Gragas Ultimate turned it into an offensive play because Someday this whole time is in a pressure position, which meant that Ku needed to press their advantage bottom lane. Ku lost absolutely everywhere, and they lost harder because Kuro tried to make up for it at the end of that last fight.
And because Smeb was in the bottom side, now he is down. We see just 100 about to 50 or 155 CS. So taking that, I mean, Smeb gets forward here. What a great
Beautiful.
Ultimate, though, from Score. And then the chain right into the traps and the taunt.
Oh, man. Arrow getting excited on that Jinx. Gorilla with a nice counter engage to let Kuro come in and do something, at least.
Yeah, big problem, too, was that death ray was very poor by Kuro, not actually hitting anybody. If he had been able to land his full combo, that may have gone the other way.
Yeah, unfortunately, Peekaboo flies in at the end, gets bopped by Kuro. Then the very end of this fight is quite interesting, because Kuro's got blue buff and level 11, so he's quite strong. Lands a death ray onto both, which gets him greedy, but that's the thing about Victor. You have two spells, and then you wait on long cooldowns.
Yeah.
After he landed those spells, he should have known that he can't finish them with auto attacks and just stayed by the wayside in safety.
You're not going to do well against a Cassiopeia that has that consistent damage output, as well as the enemy AD carry. A little bit too brave for Kuro there, and that's going to allow KT as well a pretty comfortable blue buff and pretty comfortable lead. 6,000 gold in 17 minutes. Pretty massive lead, actually, when you look at it.
Looking early like we're going to be getting that game five.
Oh, boy.
Could be.
I love game fives, chat.
It's not blind dude.
Oh,
game five.
Who's going to be super happy about that? In the game five blind pick they played over in the LCK, they played against Ashe, Leona, and Elise
type of strategy, right?
Without bringing cleanse because they didn't know they were going to be facing up against that level of chain CC.
Yeah.
Ku also, I feel like they've won picks and bans in three out of the four games so far. This one, KT had a nice curveball with the
Cassio. Oh, what an engage by Score to throw Gorilla and Prey back into the enemy team. Gorilla pops that ultimate so tanky. It's going to run out, though, and so is his life. Arrow with another kill.
And somehow,
just to save Prey, and
Someday is dead in the top side. Looks like Hojin and Smeb teaming up for a kill onto the KT top laner. Looks like we will see a turret trade and everything is said and done. Prey recalling right now, but we'll just stay back to defend the turret.
Yeah, Ku should be able to get this top lane turret before too long.
All things considered, that's actually a very good trade for the Ku Tigers, being down 7,000 gold, being able to trade a gank kill plus turret push. It'll stay good as long as they can defend this inner turret, which it looks like they'll be able to.
Yeah, and just like that, they've cut the 6,000 deficit down to 4,000.
Yeah, the big question is how big is this Cassiopeia going to get, though?
Yeah.
Because you have a 7,000 gold lead right now, 6,000 now. And the Cassiopeia is only going to get stronger, so Someday decides to dribble his way into
the ultimate. So he hides
it
in the wall.
Positioning.
So
wow.
He can't get it off.
Hiding your vitals, always a smart thing to do against Fiora.
At the same time, he hit his vitals, and then Hojin had no problems landing the skill shots on the stationary areas.
Well, Someday was just a hair's breadth away from using his ultimate right there, too. He dived his ult still up if he hadn't gotten cocooned at that precise moment. So good timing from Hojin. Turned that battle around, but
yep.
I love these duels. I love Fiora versus Darius. It's just absolutely hilarious.
Definitely is.
Yeah, to answer your previous question about how big will Cassiopeia get, though, I feel like Nagne is going to get pretty gargantuan. He's already about 80 mana away from max stacking his Archangel Staff and transforming it into a Seraph's Embrace. I think that's what makes Cassiopeia so dangerous, especially in a matchup against Victor.
Oh, taunt on the Gorilla.
Oh, Boo
being
a
bit brave, though. Yeah, there's a headbutt. Peekaboo could be in a bit of trouble. Teleport's coming in for both sides. Canceled, though, for KT as Peekaboo runs away. And the ace in the hole, not enough to finish him off. But here comes Smeb. Grand challenge on to Score. Score's going to try to get away from that blue buff. And Gorilla comes in for the engage. Score's still in trouble. There's the kill. There's the heal. And Kuro now with a clear line for the damage on the arrow. Can he do it a little bit more? And the auto attack gives Kuro the double kill. Someday, a bit late to the party. And I think time's out for him. He's going to try it all. Oh, he got it though with the gravity field. Triple kill for Kuro.
I love
it. Oh, man.
I love how Gravity Field freezes animations for the most epic of interruptions. And
that was fantastic.
It's remarkable how Ku Tigers is coming back from this 6,000 pre-20-minute gold deficit, but it's almost classic Ku Tigers in that sense. Kuro on Victor is starting to take over this game. At least he is attempting to. Smeb was able to proc the appropriate amount of vitals. And KT just reached a little bit too far here.
Let's watch this one again. You know, Peekaboo has been making a lot of aggressive plays all game, and here's one that starts off a fight that does not go well for KT.
Well, here's the thing. With Score coming in, you see the TP start to fall. I think that KT expected this teleport that we're looking at from Smed to be canceled, because that's absolutely insane. But considering the cancel from the KT teleport, it was a 5v4 in the end. Ku with the nerves of steel, and you have to make plays like that if you want to get back in the game.
Yeah, and then Kuro obviously gets the healing from Smeb. Great gravity field placement around the bend, landing every single skill shot, weaving in his auto attacks. And at this point, Someday was cut off. He's basically just trying to make an escape, but Gorilla lands both of his skills really well, knock him back. That would have been a Kuro kill. Good night, Darius.
Insane. He's on fire, literally.
The ultimate rejection. At the peak of his jump.
Rejected. Well,
oh no.
Someday you dunk, some days you get dunked.
Also, we'll have to get a replay because our replay missed a kill on to Score, which actually gives Ku the window to go and take this dragon.
Wow.
Which is shockingly going to be the first dragon of the game here at 22 minutes.
That has got to be one of the latest dragons we've seen here at Worlds, and Ku getting it. That's a nice big damage boost at this point in the game when people have some items. 6% makes a big difference. Exactly 6% of the difference, I suppose. Think about it.
You stop to analyze that one for just a second.
There you go. As I often do.
Yeah.
Let's watch Score die.
Oh boy.
Uh-oh.
He has just no control of his own jungle, and Ku is actually prepping the Baron. So a nice little bait there, knowing that they'd won the fight so substantially, going over to Baron, which necessitates a check. It's early on in the game, so they can't actually kill the Baron. Instead, they just bait the Baron. And that's just a smart strategic play, Ku knowing exactly where to gain their advantages from, even though they still hold a pretty big gold deficit. It goes to show how far behind they were.
Well, this is classic Ku Tigers, Jat. Get rocked in the early game, somehow, some way. Make it back in.
Pretty much.
6,000 plus gold at like 17 minutes. That should basically be it.
I guarantee you right now, KT does not feel like the 3,000 gold ahead, though. Or 2,000 gold, how it is now.
Yeah, I got confirmation, too. That was the latest first dragon at Worlds.
Wow.
In the tournament to this point. So 22 minutes. Very delayed, but there's been a lot of fighting in this game. And emphasis on the towers. So KT, I still think it comfortably has a scaling advantage here with this Cassiopeia. Of course, the Fed Victor going to cut into that just a little bit.
And how many times have we seen it with Ku winning and we say, well, the mistake is that they gave Kuro Victor. Well, here we are again in KT fighting for their tournament life and they gave Kuro Victor. It's a dangerous thing to do against the Ku Tigers.
Yeah, Score does have his flash up and Kuro was down a flash. I think one of the biggest weaknesses of Victor is when people can get directly on top of him and displace him. Yeah. He is mobile and he has good defenses when you're running at him, but if you successfully close the distance, he can be punished. And Ku is in the danger right now where they have such a high concentration of their gold onto a flashless mage right now, and that is their weak point. Or their vital spot, you could say.
KT may try to take advantage of Someday coming up the river right now. Looks like he's going to be too late to catch Ku. They've already taken down the turret. So Ku Tiger's safe for the moment anyway.
Yeah, but Smev sacrificing a lot of farm for this, and he's falling further and further and further behind, 164 to 237.
Wow.
The farm at the moment, but they're able to get a little bit of gold, global gold onto him before sending him into that bottom side. And someday, you know, he does have a tendency to take over games like this as a player.
And I think it's very critical for the Fiora to not fall behind, because the team fighting of the Fiora, I think, is much weaker than the team fighting of a Darius when they're even or when Darius is ahead on gold. It's not the same in the other way. All three games that Smeb has played so far in Fiora, he's gotten that advantage in the split push, and it's been very key to Ku finding the victories, because he either burns a key summoner during the split push before the team fight or flanks around while they're already ahead. This time, Sunday has been able to equalize that and actually get an edge.
Yeah, he's about 1,300 gold ahead at the moment, too, which is quite substantial. And when we're talking about this specific team composition from KT, they have so many executes, Darius ult, Jinx ult, but it's the damage over time and the AoE damage from Jinx and Cassiopeia that are setups for a possible Darius pentakill here that is very, very dangerous.
You can tell that Ku knows this. You can tell they're aware of it. They sent Smeb down to the bot lane to get a little bit of farm by himself, try to catch up a little bit of that CS deficit. So we'll see if he can. He's got his teleport, so he can join his team if he needs to.
I also have to point out that Someday built the Quicksilver Sash. We've been talking about how good Smeb has been at proccing all those vitals, which does 40% crew damage if you proc all four of them at this point of the game. But he can just QSS when Fiora ults on him and get rid of that threat.
Yeah, very true. And also QSS out of a very embarrassing gravity field once in a while. may want to save him for that one.
No more stylish poses.
No. Okay. It's very cool. Oh, Bigaboo blocks the damage that was destined for Arrow with that ace in the hole. An intense moment in the game. It's really a situation where it could go either way. A minute 30 till the next dragon. The second dragon in the game, even though we're about 27 minutes in. Oh, score getting collapsed on. Arrow's right there, though. Kuro forced to flash away. Pickaboo comes in with that stand. United. Kuro gonna get taken out by the Jinx Rocket. And now Someday trying to flee here. KT wants to get a fight. Smeb comes in. He's gonna ult Pickaboo and not be able to finish him off. A dangerous moment for Ku. Without Kuro, they don't have a whole lot of damage.
Oh, they're still hunting, though. There's the QSS.
Worked. He got out of that Elise cocoon.
Yeah, really made a big difference.
Sure
success.
Did. Wow, that item. Worth it. Whoa, KT going for Baron right now with Kuro out of commission. They're going to try it, but if Ku can delay it, it's only 12 seconds until he comes back. Prey taunted Pickaboo. Get him, it's overly aggressive. There's a kill for Prey. Gorilla pops that ult, stays alive. Prey getting some nice angles for damage on the edge of this fight. Smeb is right there as well, too. Ku a bit. Oh, there they go. They caught Someday. No QSS. No more Darius, and Ku turns the fight around Nagne. Chaos Storm on top of him as he slithers to safety for the moment.
I don't think that Baron play is ever going to work for KT.
I don't think so either.
Teleport up and is up in 10 seconds. KT so close to taking control of this game once again, with Score making a nice catch on a curl. I think Score has played fantastically this series, but KT just makes a team-wide mistake with that call to go for Baron.
Well, I think it's fine if you want to peel off of the Baron and try and finish up that fight, but KT just didn't do that. Pickaboo went in too early, got chunked out, had to flash out of that engagement, and there wasn't follow-up. So very poorly played here by KT. He got spotted by Prey. That was actually a very nice trinket.
Beautiful trinket by Prey. At that point, Pickaboo would need to run away because his team was still during the Baron. Smeb also has flank position right here, which makes the retreat even more difficult. And I love the headiness as well of Kuro to buy home guards when he respawned because he knew he needed to close on this fight. Zooms ahead, gets the spells on Inagne and completely pushes him out of the fight.
Arrow nearly died to Prey's ultimate that fight too. Now Ku able to take an easy second dragon. And just like that, gold lead for Ku Tigers after being down 6K. Man, these teams are so close every single game, back and forth. But in game four, the game that could send the Ku Tigers to the semifinals, they've taken the lead once again.
I think that was just a huge error from KT. They knew Kuro's teleport was up and available. And the death timers, I mean, we're still sub 30 minutes into this game, so they're not going to be so long yet. And Kuro has somehow managed to find a two-level lead on Nagne here, despite having approximately even CS.
Yeah.
I mean, they've been winning fight after fight, and Kuro's just consistently been able to clear minion waves. Not to mention he got slingshot a little bit because KT was ahead on experience and gold, so because he was the lower experience member, he gained more experience for the kills, and KT honestly just hasn't killed them back since there's been no turning back since this game started to reverse.
You know, now Smeb is down a lot on CS, but he's got enough items that he is relevant. And look at this, two turrets just like that already with this Baron buff from the Ku Tigers. And Smeb trying to make a plan to someday here. This is brave. Gorilla can't protect him with Arrow auto-attacking him from over the wall. And Smeb has to back away. Whoa, Smeb
blocks
the ultimate.
It is just not something.
Whoa, no, it is not. And now the inhibitor in a lot of trouble. Ku Tigers have broke open the door of KT's base.
Yeah, this is really an amazing comeback by Ku Tigers in this game.
He reposted that ultimate. That was awesome.
I mean, I've been so impressed. Smeb looked a bit shaky in game one, but ever since then on this Fiora, it's been really quite impressive.
Yeah, KT needs to make a play right now if they want to save this inhibitor, if they want to save their game. I don't know if they can, though. That cannon minion's doing damage. Someday gets jumped on.
Oh,
they're trying to make a play there. Chaos Storm not doing enough. They get the inhibitor. They get Peekaboo. And they can just back away. No need to put any more pressure on. They got what they came for and more.
This could be Ku moving on to the semifinals. If this happened,
could.
It would actually be one team from every group moving on to the semifinals.
Wow. Well, that's great. And coming into this, you know, a lot of people, myself included, were predicting KT. It's not over yet, but Ku bringing some stuff we were not expecting. Let's watch that fight again. Smeb.
Well, they basically just make a decision right here. And Smeb, there's the riposte.
Nope. Oh.
And they wanted to make a play. They send their damage dealers over to that side to try and get a pick and then move the game forward from there. But instead, they just end up losing their inhibitor turret.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Look at the gold differences all the way until roughly about the 28-minute mark. In favor of KT, and then Ku bringing it right back again.
Yeah, and it's made worse by the fact that KT actually had and has a pretty good scaling team composition. If Nungne can get in the right positions on Cassiopeia,
yeah.
Score can catch the squishy targets out of position, and Arrow can shoot from the back line. Even if the gold is like this around 32 minutes, KT is by no means out of it, but they just feel really disorganized at this point of the game. Ku Tigers has so much momentum, and I feel like their mentality is stronger. They're making the proper calls, and I've seen a lot of really poor decisions from Peekaboo and the rest of KT in the last 15 minutes.
Well, when Ku Tigers' group is five, we found it's really hard to stop these guys, and KT could still definitely turn this game around. They've got to get some confidence back. After those last couple fights, anybody would be feeling not that great.
And it goes to show the swinginess of this game. Your normal Baron power play gives about 3,000 gold. 6,448 from that last one.
Yep. Smeb split pushing here with those super minions in the bot lane as Ku Tigers move towards the inhibitor turret up top.
Score has his flash right now. You would hope that he tries to pull the trigger on a body slam flash, but they need to clear these super minions away from their Nexus turret first. Darius doesn't actually do it that quickly.
Yeah. Oh,
they're going to lose
a Nexus turret. They do.
Great pressure there. They wanted just to have Peekaboo in that bottom side trying to run interference, but Smeb goes down there in the 4-1 split, working wonders once again for Ku.
So Ku's going to back away. A minute 40 until that next dragon comes back. They're going to find Prey, though. Uh-oh. Could be an opportunity, but nope. Prey able to net his way to safety. I call that a net win for the Ku Tigers. Don't worry, I'm going
we'll
back
see.
To pre-op today.
gotta shove the bad jokes in
get
there
on
while
the plane
you can.
As fast as I can. Yeah. I gotta get out of here. Yep. Oh, Score finds some Ku Tigers players. Ku trying to find time to recall and buy some items. They're able to do it. Minute until the next dragon.
Look at the vision control right now from the Ku Tigers. It is just so complete around that Baron. They have absolute information about what is happening in the enemy jungle, and that's going to be very useful when some of these objectives start to pop in about a minute. Mm-hmm. Well, they should be very comfortable, and Ku looking like it'll be a pretty easy closure to this game, barring some sort of catastrophic teamfight that KT can engineer.
Yeah, especially Nagne yet to hit his death cap. Because of the way Cassiopeia works as well, he's been slowly stacking up the aspect of the Serpent. He's at 420 stacks. At 500, of course, he gets a bonus 40% of ability power.
It's a lot.
And then the death cap would make it so much. So he would go from about 500 to 1,000 AP if this game does stretch to 40 minutes. So there actually is still some stalling KT can do if they stop the relentlessness of Ku Tigers so far.
Well, they definitely know that. Who knows it too? It's still a very tense game between these two teams. That 5K gold lead at this point in the game doesn't mean a whole lot. Who's going to get this next Baron, though? This next Baron fight is going to, I would say, almost certainly decide the winner of the game. Dragon's going to KT, or to Ku, rather.
And the Baron is really not coming at the right time for KT Rolster. They're already down a Nexus turret, and their inhibitor is yet to respawn. They can't commit people down to that Baron area, and I don't even know if they want to, because a 5-on-5 fight at this point, before Cassiopeia hits that late-game form, is not very ideal. Like, this actually is a Baron you might need to give up 100%.
I mean, and if you do that, you kind of wonder if you can stop the Ku Tigers.
Well, the nice thing KT has going for them is great kiting potential, so they're not really going to be able to be dove with Cassiopeia and Shen at some of these turrets, so maybe that would be the way to discourage a game from ending, but again, you have the Victor Gravity Field and the Caitlyn to siege, so it still would be hard. This is a very, very tough decision for KT.
It was a very high percentage win here for the Ku Tigers based on the current circumstances. It'll really be down to their execution, in my opinion, because even if they want to dive turrets, they have Alistar, one of the best champions for such situations, getting the flat damage reduction.
Yeah.
The longer KT can stall, though, the better it is for them. Death cap was completed by Nagne, and their inhibitor has respawned.
Just came back.
That's great timing for them, really. They managed to prevent the instant Baron take. We do see Someday fading back into...
Uh-oh. It's a trap.
His Nexus Fountain.
It's a trap. And are they going to catch score here? Maybe. Ace of the Hole comes in. They get him with the Cocoon. Score could be going down. Tries to make it out. Looks like he'll barely live.
They used a lot on that, though. They're going to go onto the Baron immediately.
Wow, okay. With score so low, they think they're safe to take it. Gorilla in the back lines hasn't used his ultimate yet, so that Alistar is still very tanky. KT, this is their season. This is their year on the line, and the Ku Tigers get the Baron. Ku back away. Someday trying to make a play with Darius, trying to get the resets. He can't. Prey with the kill, and with Someday out of the way, KT's worlds may be over.
That was such a well-executed Baron by the Ku Tigers. They had the wards around. As soon as they saw score, immediately dumped the damage on him so he would have a very hard time actually contesting that Baron, and then kept the pressure on Gorilla on the outside, never letting him even get a chance for a steal, and forcing the...
Uh-oh, Smeb onto Pickaboo. A lot of damage done there. He's going to use the ultimate even through the exhaust. Gorilla comes in to try to support his top laner. Score! Takes a dirt nap, and Kuro takes a lot of damage, but they're going to send Nagne back towards the base as well as they take out another inhibitor. Ku, low health, but they are taking apart KT's base, going for another one. I think it might be time to go back after this. We'll see if they decide they can end it.
See Smeb right there, mouth moving. He is the main shot caller for the Ku Tigers. So they are just going to back off, take the Baron, take the two inhibitors that they managed to get. KT stays alive for just a little bit longer.
Man, I mean, it is about as close as it can possibly get with the picks that Ku have been making here.
Yeah, Ku, just a continuous play of success right there, I'd have to say. Pickaboo making a lot of unfortunate mistakes. I feel like the taunt at the very beginning of that Baron fight on an Alistar where he extended his flash would have been wondrous if he could have joined Someday in that fight on the inside. And then as far as the double inhib taking, that's about as best the KT could have hoped for. It's lucky that the game actually isn't over.
Uh-oh.
If Arrow dies, though, I think the game is over.
Smeb trying to find him. Gorilla's right there. Arrow taking a lot of damage. Gorilla comes in. Score trying to save his AD carry. Pushes Gorilla back into him, though. Turret doing damage to Alistar. Pickaboo gets the taunt. Gorilla could be in trouble. Has to use that ultimate to stay alive, but he can't. Arrow with a kill, and KT may have found an opportunity, but there are so many super minions coming into the base. Does Ku even need Gorilla to be alive right now?
Well, the minions aren't there quite yet, so KT wants to hold this a bit longer, but
there
it goes.
They're going in. They want to fight the 4v5. Smeb at about half health. This may be a bit too dangerous, but Ku, they see victory right in front of them. They see a dead inhibitor as well. That's all three inhibitors down now. KT in a bit of trouble. They're going to send Smeb to push up this bottom lane. Hey, dueling with Someday. Gotta be careful there. I wouldn't want to duel with the Darius, especially at this point in the game. That Nexus turret getting a bit low as Score comes from the side. Peekaboo there as well. Score gets taken down. A kill for Kuro. And Ku, with that kill, may have done it. The Nexus is exposed. And in summer season, it was KT Rolster. But Ku with a chance at revenge in just four games this time. And there it is. Ku Tigers go to the semifinals.
Wow. Coming second place out of their group, too, behind the Flash Wolves. Come in here and deliver a vintage Ku Tigers performance, playing from behind, showing the strength of their team fight against Shot Calling, and these guys are elated.
Ku really stepped it up in this series. Smeb in particular, even when he was behind in lane, he had the strength in team fighting, the right pick potential. Kuro went back on the old picks and Victor.
Yeah.
Prey had successful ultimates in these team fights and had good positioning. Really, it was a team effort, but on the back of Smith.
You know, since the spring season, since what happened at IM Katowice, people have been asking, can the Ku Tigers perform on the international stage? I would say this is a resounding yes, as Ku Tigers are moving on to the semifinals. What a series.
Yeah, very nicely played. And we look at KT's bans in this series. Vhagar, Kennen, Tahm Kench. These are bans that are now necessary against the Ku Tigers. We've seen what Gorilla can do on Tahm Kench.
Yeah.
We know they can flex the Kennen very well. The Vhagar has become a threat with their siege compositions. So Ku has such a wide array of strategies at their disposal right now. They've shown quite a bit.
Yeah, and despite, you know, the follies in the early game, still coming back with a strong late game. And KT Rolster, you know, this is not the end of the season that they wanted, of course, wanted to make it farther than the quarterfinals. A successful year. You know, it was a big season of turmoil in Korea with so many players going to China. KT had to kind of pick up the pieces when Peekaboo came in, turned this team around, got them to Worlds, and played well in the group stages. Thought it'd go a little bit farther, but still a respectable year for that organization.
Yeah, and I feel pretty bad for scoring this one because I think he played amazingly.
He did play
pretty
great
much all the early and mid games, but the team itself just didn't seem to quite click. Ku was playing some really smart League of Legends, which requires you to be completely cohesive in your shot calling towards a mid late game, and that, along with the pick and bans, I think, is where KT fell short.
Yeah, how about that? Ku Tigers, a team made up of players that were essentially rejected from other teams and players that had been formally retired.
I mean,
coming back, it's an interesting story to see. Prey especially took like a year off, and he's coming back, playing like this, going to the semifinals at Worlds. Amazing stuff.
His second World semifinals, in fact, after being on Najin Black Sword. It actually was, you know, a battle between Nagne and Prey, two of those old Najin Sword players that made the semis and lost to SKT in Season 3. But I want to talk about Smeb. This guy has been absolutely amazing. To talk about his development as a player, sure, the exodus happens. A lot of these players leave. He was on Incredible Miracle, looking very poor at times.
Yeah.
But my God, has he gotten better and really, really improved this year.
It's crazy, like Smeb, because in 2014, you never would have called this guy a strong top laner.
Not
he was far from it, but pretty strong in the 2015.
Yeah, and it's been obviously an up and down season too, because the spring for Ku Tigers was kind of the split of Smeb, and then they did slump at the beginning of summer, but he seems to be back on form, and he's really, I think, the first one to fully display the power of Fiora and take advantage of all of her strengths, because we thought Fiora was going to be such a priority pick coming into the World Championship, and then it wasn't. But here it is again.
Well, we can talk about the rest of his champion pool coming in too, because sure, he played a ton of Fiora tonight, but we've also seen he's pretty damn good at Darius, to the degree that KT thought it was best to ban it, keep it away from him in this series. He's a Riven Pentakill. He had one this summer, so he's able to play so many different carry top laners at the elite level at the moment that it should be quite interesting to see him go up against Huni in the semifinals.
I can't wait to hear what he has to say in our interview in a few minutes here. It's going to be cool, but that Fiora is going to be nearly a must ban for anyone facing the Ku Tigers from here on out.
At this point, there's a lot of things that are nearly must ban because they've shown excellence on so many of the meta picks. And I think Ku answered a lot of questions tonight as well. They were in the group of life, so to speak, and didn't even win that group against the Flash Wolves, who looked very sloppy in our first quarterfinals. So a lot of people were thinking maybe Ku just didn't have it in them, not to mention all of the struggles they'd had at international events in the past, like IEM Katowice. So I think this is just a really redeeming game for KU, the team of veterans who had actually failed on the international stage prior.
I think the main issue they had is when it came down to it, those high-pressure matches, the KU Tigers kind of tended to collapse. We saw it at IEM Katowice. We saw it in Korea as well in certain matches. But towards the end of summer season, it really was looking like they had solved those issues. And with that last best of five we just saw, winning it in four games over KT Rolster, I think those issues are long gone now for the KU Tigers. So we're going to throw it down to Shox for an interview with KU's top laner.
Thank you very much, Doa. And congratulations, SMEB, getting to the semifinals with the KU Tigers. I want to talk a little bit about the last game. We know you guys are good at comebacks, and you didn't see it, but you were down 6,000 gold around 20 minutes. How did you manage to do it and come back from that?
이제 쿠 타이거즈 팀이 워낙 역전극을 잘하기로 좀 유명한 팀이기도 하지만 이제 스맵 선수는 모르셨겠지만 6천 골드나 이제 뒤지고 있었거든요. 이제 그런 상황에서 어떻게 역전극을 만들어셨는지 좀 말씀해 주세요.
저희가 좀 슬로우 스타터인 것 같아요. 그래서 연습 때는 막 저희가 막 긴장도 안 하고 하니까 좀 처음부터 막 몰아치는 플레이가 가능한데 대회만 오면은 특히 초반에 좀 무너지면은 많이 힘들더라고요. 그래서 그래도 최대한 열심히 해보자라는 생각으로 했던 것 같아요.
So I think in general we're a very slow starter. Like during scrims, we play very aggressively and it works quite well. But I think at the actual tournament, we get quite nervous and doesn't work the way we planned. So during this game, we just said, let's not give up. Let's keep doing our own plays. And I think that's how we managed to come back.
All right. And quite nervous for the series, of course, for a spot in the semifinal in the summer playoffs. You guys played KT, and I can imagine you were looking for revenge. A lot of people thought it would go all the way to five games and be a lot closer. Why do you think it was that all of a sudden you seemed to be better in a lot of things than KT in this matchup?
이제 지금 KT와의 대결이 지난 썸머 플레이오프 때 이제 지기도 해서 살짝 복수전이기도 했고, 많은 사람들이 좀 더 치열하고 좀 5경기까지 가는 그런 접전이 일어날 거라 예상했었는데 쿠 타이거즈는 어떻게 준비를 해서 이렇게 좀 비교적으로 상대적 우위를 점할 수 있었는지 말씀해 주세요.
저번 마지막 그 KT전은 저희가 사실 자신감이 있었는데 준비할 시간이 너무 없었어요. 그래서 저희가 블라인드 픽까지 준비를 했었었는데 그걸 못 해가지고 좀 아쉽게 패배한 것 같고 저희는 근데 저희 팀은 모르겠는데 저는 그 저희가 준비만 열심히 하고 준비한 대로만 된다면은 무조건 이길 수 있다고 생각했어요.
So during the summer playoffs, our team was very confident, but I don't think we were just prepared enough, especially for the blind pick, the blind match, the fifth game. So for this coming match, I don't know for the whole team, but at least for myself, I was very confident that if we prepared well enough, that we could beat KT, and I think it went well along to the, according to the plan.
According to the plan, I think if there was a blind pick here, you would have probably picked Fiora. Four games on her in this one. Tell me about the champion and how you experienced playing her. Is it the combination SMEB plus Fiora that is so destructive? Because you had a fantastic set.
그 이제 피오라로 되게 네 경기 내내 엄청난 활약을 보이셨는데 이제 SMEB 선수와 피오라에게 어떠한 그 좀 작용하는 것이 있길래 이렇게 잘하셨는지 피오라로 피오라 픽에 대해 설명해 주세요.
사실 그 탑에서 이렇게 패치가 많이 바뀌면서 뭐 다리우스나 피오라 같은 챔프가 많이 나왔잖아요. 그래서 좀 연습을 하던 도중에 전 다리우스가 최고라고 생각했어요. 그래서 다리우스만 연습했는데 이게 연습 때 보니까 피오라도 괜찮은 거예요. 그래서 제 스타일에도 좀 맞는 것 같고 그래서 연습하게 됐어요.
So after the Juggernaut patch at the 5.18, at first I thought Darius was the best pick. But then after practicing Fiora a couple games, I thought Fiora better fit my own style. So that's how I got to play it a lot during this series.
Yeah, and you are very good on it. That will possibly be a very interesting pick in the next round. Semi-final versus, of course, Fnatic. What a matchup. And Huni said in an OGN interview yesterday that he was very much looking forward to playing you. He's also said that he wants to prove that he's the best top laner in the entire tournament. What can you tell me about that matchup versus Huni?
예, 내일 이제 다음 주 4강전에서 이제 후니 선수와 탑 매치업이 남아 있는데 후니 선수가 어제 승자 인터뷰에서 온겐나 인터뷰에서 스맵 선수랑 붙는 것을 되게 이제 고대하고 있다고 얘기를 했었고 이전에도 후니 선수가 이번 대회를 통해서 자기가 최고의 탑 라인이라는 것을 증명하겠다고 얘기를 했어요. 그거에 대해서 어떻게 생각하시나요?
사실 저도 Fnatic과의 대결을 정말 이렇게 기대하고 있고요. 후니 선수도 정말 좋은 모습 많이 보여주는데 패기는 좋은데 아직 노련함이 좀 적지 않나 싶어서 제가 잘 이길 수 있을 것 같아요.
I'm also very looking forward playing against Fnatic at the semifinals, and I do admit that Huni's a very good player, and he has that confidence, but I think he lacks experience, so I think I could beat him.
All right, well, it's going to be a fantastic matchup overall. Thank you so much, and congratulations, Smeb and the Koo Tigers in the semifinal. For us, we're going to go back to our guys at the analyst desk.
Thank you, Shox. The 3-1 victory there for Koo. Interestingly enough, this means that one team from each group has qualified for the semifinals. We have Koo from Group A, Fnatic from Group B, SKT from Group C, and Origin from Group D. So everyone making a representation in the semifinals. But I do want to dive into this game because Koo once again, and Smeb specifically on that Fiora, played very well. To close it out.
The laning phase was not pretty, to be honest. He fell behind by, I think, 70 CS at one point, but that didn't matter. It looked like he was playing the same Fiora that he played the previous game, which was tower diving left, right, and center. And again, Koo comes out with a better composition that can be executed into the weaknesses of KT, which they very gladly just pick every single time, and to be expected, a clean win from them.
There's been a lot of talk about the Darius versus Fiora matchup, and I was talking about how Fiora is very, very similar to Riven when you learn the intricacies of it, and Smeb kind of echoed that sentiment there, saying he thought Darius was the one to go for, but then once you learn the mechanics on Riven, you're able to take that away. So when it's Fiora versus Darius, you end up having the burden of execution be on Fiora. It's her decisions that really affect that lane, when she riposts, when she actually dives in which direction. So the way that that's played out is when you have enough games on Fiora and he has been putting the time in, you take that matchup, I would say 70% of the time, if you have the skills to do so.
It's like what I want to hit on is KT. Like KT with the draft, I feel like they try to copy Fnatic in a way where they pick a stronger mid lane matchup that can roam, that LeBlanc game specifically against EDG. They pick a strong mid laner that can outpush. Cassiopeia is considered quite strong into Victor because this matchup is very punishing, but later on, of course, Victor wins because of scaling. And then you have this top lane matchup that score always kind of figures out for them. But the missing piece that they didn't pick up while they were looking at Fnatic was their AD carries that they always pick is in the shape of Sivir, Kennen. Sure, they played some Jinx yesterday as well, but it didn't really set them up to enable this pressure that came from these other lanes. The Jinx, sure, it works into the late game, but you're not going to win in the late game anyway. So just try to play on the pressure that you have, which came from the early game, from the mid and the top. To transition that into bottom, pick a Kennen and pressure that.
Yeah, not only were KT's drafts just a little strange every time, they were lacking engage. They were getting early leads, but they didn't have a way to really push that lead and force their will onto their opponent.
Exactly.
And they were kind of waiting for them to do things. But aside from that, we saw Peekaboo making some very odd decisions, getting caught out, taunting into one person, and then just really not having the perfect setup. It seemed like some frustration there that they couldn't close games out, that they had advantages and they needed these fights. But then also, you look at Nagne. He's usually giving so much damage later on, but this was an underperformance from a lot of members from KT here.
Well, for sure. I do think that Koo played pretty well to have that comeback victory, on top of the fact that it was a little sloppy, them getting caught out in certain instances, but what really stood out was the chaining the CCs during these team fights. They have a compositions with a lot of crowd control. You saw with the Caitlyn traps into the Veigar cage. You have the headbutt pulverized. And I think the only one that was remotely botched was one in the bot lane with a gank on with Elise and Alistar. But besides that, the chaining of crowd control with Victor on top of that, I mean, the Victor was just stellar. Probably the best Victor in the tournament. Maybe Faker can contest that, but I'd be looking at that pick.
All right, a couple of the things I want to explore. We already mentioned that there were a few games in which Koo did get behind. So when we look forward in the tournament against teams that are even more willing to put pressure on, Fnatic as an example, you know, how are they going to buff up that early game to make sure they don't get 3-4K behind and against a team comp that won't let them back in?
I think it comes down to the jungling. Lee Hojin didn't have a very stellar jungle performance, particularly with the jungle pathing. You know, he was in wrong places at the wrong times, and we highlighted that he fell behind two levels in the jungle. By the time that score was level 7, he was level 5, and that's because he kept sitting in the top lane brush just waiting for something to happen, based purely on intuition and not really actual ward knowledge. So once he focuses on playing with the information that you have instead of your intuition, which may be wrong or may be incredibly right, you will have a better showing.
And that's where I want to flip to the other side of the matchup, Zyrine. Score for me on KT was the big performer of the day. Even with the loss, was coming up huge, making a lot of plays, really had a great presence around the map.
Yeah, if KT ended up winning, Score was probably going to be player of the series. He was having such consistent performances from every single game. He was getting his top laner ahead. Sometimes someday would throw that away, and then he would go bottom and he'd get his bottom in advantage. And these are where those early game advantages were coming from, was Score's pathing, and also his casks were just really good, catching prey out a couple times and being able to continue to keep that momentum up. Some nice steals in the first few games on objectives, but then it just didn't seem to have the same type of impact because he had to be like an S++, which does not exist, in order to be able to carry his team through a lot of these games.
I feel like Hojin was like the bigger downfall when it comes to KU Tigers. Like first, when I heard of Hojin, I was like, oh, they replaced Lee, finally. And then Zyrine told me, like at the start of this tournament, Lee is actually just Hojin Renek.
It's the same guy.
And then when I saw him in these games, like the things that Lee used to do, like these inconsistent patterns, they came back and I got worried for a second. And seeing that like against a team like Fnatic in the future, Rainover is pretty consistent in his patterns. He's going for that top lane gank and he always has a plan. So I'm kind of worried in that particular matchup. That is what is exposed for KU Tigers.
I'm also very worried about that matchup because both of these jungle pools, you can pinch these jungle pools. Whoever gets Elise in this matchup has a huge advantage. I wouldn't be surprised if you're seeing Rek'Sai and Elise bans on every blue side, or at least maybe one of them and forcing the other one to be banned because you'll get one yourself. I think that you can pinch this pool pretty hard.
I think it's less so of whoever gets Elise and just Elise is broken. You can't be like, you just can't beat this champion. It's too strong right now with the tower diving. It's how we talked about, you pick Elise, you've won the lanes for everybody else. Like, hey guys, I'm existing. I'm doing my job.
Yeah, very much so. But you bring up a good point, which is pinching of champions and the distribution of champions in pick and ban. Because once again, with the performance of Smeb on Fiora, we're seeing now Fiora, Tahm Kench, the
Vhagar,
mandatory Mord and GP bans, the Vhagar, all the Elise being a huge pick. And then that's without even target banning any specific team, where now you're saying like, well, we want to get Azir out against this guy or Victor. What do you do now? All of a sudden, this is making champions like very interesting in terms of how teams are going to allocate the power and where they put their bans.
I actually think the pattern that had the Fnatic had in the group stage was to kind of disrespect the opponent, particularly the Yasuo top game, and saying, you know what, we're just going to beat you with what you have. We'll beat you with just a weaker pick, but we can outskill you with it. That was kind of the, I'm not sure if it was Huni's mentality or the team mentality, but that's why it was picked. Riven, on the other hand, is a champion that we have no idea how the matchup into Fiora goes at the highest level. This is the first time we've seen Fiora really showcase in all four games back-to-back. Okay, these are the limits of the champion. How crazy does it get into the late game? Okay, very crazy. What about Riven? How does Riven do into that? I'm guarantee you, Huni and Smeb don't have a lot of matchup into that because not all the top laners here play those two champions, so there's not a lot of practice.
Final thoughts on the champs league.
I think it comes down to what idea people have coming into champions. Like, for example, when it comes to KT, they have this idea that Darius is a stronger part, but against Fnatic, they've shown the Riven. So that is one way of dealing with these stronger champions. If you find a way to deal with these champions, you don't need to ban them. And GP Mordekaiser, there's no way of dealing with these champions. They just have to be banned.
All right. Well, we're going to take an opportunity to head backstage where Deficio is standing by with KU's victorious jungler.
Thank you very much, Dash. I'm joined by Hojin from the KU Tigers. He just qualified to the semifinal where he's taking on Fnatic, of course. My first question is, back at IM Katowice, you guys didn't have a great performance. Now you're top four in the world all of a sudden. What has changed for the KU Tigers compared to back then at IM Katowice?
호진 선수 우선 4강 진출을 축하드리고요. 이제 KU Tigers가 IM전 때는 이제 살짝 안 좋은 모습을 보여주셨는데 이번에 완전 다른 모습으로 롤드컵 이제 상위 4개 팀에 지금 들어갔습니다. 그 당시 쿠타이거즈랑 지금 쿠타이거즈는 어떻게 달라졌는지 좀 설명해 주세요.
저희가 항상 저희 팀의 원동력이 뭐냐, 강함의 원동력이 뭐냐고 물으면 저희는 항상 이 친구 같은 가족 같은 그런 분위기라고 말하거든요. 근데 그 분위기가 저희를 약간 좀 쉽게 좀 건방지게도 좀 만들고 이렇게 좀 긴장도 빨리 풀리게 만들어서 아마 그게 좀 패착의 원인이 되었던 것 같아서 저희가 정말 보완하려고 많이 노력해서 이번에 좀 많이 준비했기 때문에 이렇게 여기까지 올 수 있는 게 아닌가 싶어요.
So whenever somebody asks what the KU Tigers' main strength is, we would answer that it's like that friendship and that connection between each other. It's like a family connection. But I think at the IEM tournament, we were a bit too confident and maybe arrogant at some point. So while coming to the World Championship, we tried really hard to fix that problem and play better as a team.
Is the friendship you guys have on your team what makes you so good at always getting back in these games? You guys were down 6,000 gold and you managed to claw your way back and you've done it before. Like, what makes you guys so good at always getting back in the game even if you fall behind early?
네, 쿠 타이거스 팀도 워낙 역전을 잘하기로 한 유명한 팀인데 이번 마지막 게임도 6,000골드 이제 좀 뒤쳐져 있었지만 결국 역전을 해냈습니다. 이 역전할 수 있는 힘에 대해서 좀 얘기해 주세요.
아까도 말했듯이 저희 그 가족 같은 그런 친근함이 단점이 될 때도 있지만 이렇게 역전할 때 장점이 되어서 역으로 작용할 수도 있기 때문에 아마 그런 이유로 저희가 이렇게 역전도 잘하고 또 운도 좀 따라줘서 그렇게 이긴 것 같아요.
So I think the main reason behind why we're so good at comebacks is, as I said in the previous question, like that connection between our teams, like that faith, leads us to come, like play better even though we're behind, and manage to come back overall.
Last question here: is KU Tigers right now the best team in the world?
마지막 질문으로 지금 KU Tigers가 세계에서 가장 강한 팀이라고 생각되나요?
솔직히 8강 치르기 전에는 저희가 정말 자신감에 차 있었고 그때 이런 질문을 물었더라면 저희가 아 당연히 저희는 최강의 팀입니다 라고 자신 있게 말할 수 있었는데 지금은 좀 약간 이렇게 탑 정글 준비를 많이 했거든요 근데 약간 이렇게 무너지는 모습을 보여서 자신감을 조금 잃긴 했는데 아마 다시 준비한다면 당연히 다시 말할 수 있을 것 같아요 저희가 최고라고
So if you asked this question before the quarterfinals, today's match, I would have said of course we're the best team in the world but today's game I think we prepared the top jungle a lot, but then we struggled quite a bit. So for now, I'm not too confident, but I think if we prepare a lot for the next semifinals, we can regain that confidence to say that once again, we're the best team in the world.
Well, I wish you the best of luck and thank you so much for the interview. Let's send it back to Adash and the guys on the analyst desk.
Thank you, DeFizio. I love the first question, the response to the first question, because it paints the picture of KU Tigers, a team that rose to dominance in the spring split, then had quite a stumble, definitely struggled for a large period of time, made their run back up into Worlds, and here they are flourishing, you know, top four teams at Worlds now, and they look pretty good. You know, Hojin there saying they can still be better, but...
Friendship's what allows them to come back. They're just a bunch of bros playing league together and just happen to make it to the semifinals of the league.
I kind of miss their cute outfits, though. They used to have such great outfits.
I always look forward to their outfits.
I think it's also the lesson of underestimating preparation. I think most teams go through this once. I remember this one game we played against Giants, who were known for playing with this Jax and Morgana every time, and we didn't ban it, and we got smacked by it. So that's like, I think it's just the lesson of preparation and appreciating, like, preparation.
And to your point, Zyrene, them not being allowed to have an infinite number of uniforms makes us look better by comparison, because they're not showing up at the tournament. And outclassing us. Turning back to the top lane, though, Smeb had an exceptional day as the Grand Duelist on the Rift and claimed our Player of the Series honors.
He just had an amazing series. Coming into here, we were looking at Someday as a guy who had so much consistency to him, but then this 1v1 matchup just kept happening all of the time, and Smeb got to a point where he was level 18 when everybody else was level 15 in the game, and he just kept coming back from deficits with Hojin at his side. Lose a little bit early, but he was always staying in it. That friendship really coming through for KU Tigers.
So the question is Fiora MVP or is Smeb MVP?
Smeb.
Smeb.
It was just
because
on the screen.
I think it was very clear based on the graphic. No, but Smeb, because of, as we mentioned, the skill cap of that champion, where sure, Fiora is a strong champion, but only if you can execute on it properly.
That's why I'm looking forward so much to Smeb versus Huni, because they both play Fiora, they both play Riven, they both are mechanically just gifted on these champions. I want to see what happens there, because we might have another Faker versus Ryu kind of outplay going.
All right, I mean, I hope to see the same. Looking at the quarterfinals as a whole, though, earlier we asked what surprised you the most in this stage of Worlds 2015. And Nick Renier tweets, no quarterfinal series has gone five games despite such an explosive and unpredictable group stage.
It's like the first thought that comes to mind. Even though some of these matchups didn't go to five games, like the Fnatic EDG, I felt it was really close, even though it was a 3-0.
Yeah, a lot of these games with different picks and bans, right? We just saw a series between KT and KU that could have gone five games if everybody was playing the pick and ban well, and then they went through and then they executed on it. But something, you know, everybody's like, oh, who do you want to win the World Championship and all that? And I'm like, you know what I really want is the finals to be all five games. We've never had a world championship finals go all five games. That's really what I want.
So we're saving up for it. Yeah. By having no five-game series in the quarters. We're gonna have a five game.
As long as
final.
I get that one.
Well, the reason you don't have those five games quarters is because the tournament meta has really stabilized. After you get the group stage goings, especially as it's divided in a couple of days in between, it really allows the teams to reassess what they did wrong and what they did right, and then come up with a better strategy, practice against each other with what they deem is the better strategy after the what they had practiced before Worlds. And then, you know, you get a lot of more refined gameplay, and it might not look the prettiest, but at least in their own context, it's the best league that they can show.
Mm-hmm. All right, next up from Eric Derua, the strength of Tom Kench has surprised me. I knew he sounded strong, but wow, he has shown his power.
Speaking of tournament meta, Tom Kench is definitely up there, in my opinion. I'm really surprised that people lagged on finding out how powerful he is. Same with Fiora. I feel like both these champions moving forward in semis and finals are going to be highly contested because they are both extraordinarily powerful, and what they do on the Rift, not many other champions can even do or contest.
It's like when I saw Tom Kench for the first time when it was released, my comparison that I drew, like when it was Portal, is just like a worse version of Thresh and Morgana, but in reality, it's just a better version of both. That's what it
you
is.
You had it all backwards, my friend. All right, well, with the quarterfinals done, let's see how the bracket settled. KU Tigers took down KT Rollstar, and we'll move on to Brussels, where they'll face Fnatic. And in our other semifinal, it's Origin and SK Telecom battling for a place on stage in Berlin. That's our show for today, but we'll be back next week starting with an all-new, hot-off-the-griddle, Belgian-style primetime league coated with all the sweet memes you've come to know and love. Then on Saturday, our Worlds coverage returns from the Brussels Expo as Europe's Origin takes on the LCK's SK Telecom T1. And on Sunday, it's Fnatic versus KU Tigers battling for a spot in the finals. Our coverage kicks off on Saturday at 4:30 p.m. Central European time. That's 7:30 a.m. Pacific. And according to EU West Kalsong Rick, Soaz will have his work cut out for him with Marin. Marin has surprised me the most. I knew he was really good, but not godlike.
Marin has definitely been a huge force to be reckoned with. And not only that...
Another Fiora player.
Exactly. He's another Fiora player, and we've seen him play from a deficit as well. And also, Marin calls a ton of the shots for that team, right? So he's a big leader for them. If you can take down Marin, or if he snowballs, he starts putting that into the rest of the game.
One of the weaknesses that he's had, though, this entire time is that he's relatively easy to gank. He plays so aggressive that whoever he's playing against can feel a little oppressed after his up-in-your-face playstyle, just always putting the pressure on. And if you just find a way to sneak a gank in there, you know, you can probably set him behind quite a bit.
If you're ganking him, you're not ganking Faker.
It's like,
why would you ever gank Faker?
Like, the beauty of Marin, yes, I find him very beautiful. The beauty of Marin to me is the fact that he fits into all of these different metas so well. It's like, we come into this world with a complete new meta, like revolving around these assassins. People questioning Marin being able to play these, like, bruisers, assassins may be the wrong word, but Fiora, Darius, and he's playing them phenomenally. The fact that he's willing to adapt and doing it really well is what is amazing to me.
You could call him a timeless top laner. Well, that does it for us today. The Worlds tonight is hitting your browsers in just 15 minutes, so stick around for the week's action broken down by myself, Spawn, and Crumbs. Now, on behalf of the entire live broadcast crew bringing you Worlds 2015, thank you for watching. We'll see you next week, and good night.
KT versus KU Tigers. Last time we saw these guys, it was epic, and I expect it will be equally, if not more, epic today.
I think they get the heal. Oh, really? Now Sunday pulls him in. Oh, and he gets one for one. In fact, Sunday got that kill. Oh. And now KT comes in. A huge every hand by Sunday, and KT all over the KU Tigers.
KT Rollstar, GG.
Get him back out of the fight. Got exhausted. Couldn't really do anything. Double kill comes in for Curl. They're going to tear apart KT. Game two goes to KU Tigers.
But no follow-up there.
Oh, never mind. Unstoppable force. Oh. For Sunday, another nice knockup comes in. Big heal for KU Tigers, and they will chase KT over the moment. KU Tigers will take a dominating game number three.
Pikaboo did not even get
it. Oh, yes, Nocte playing it dangerously. The double kill, Someday, a bit late to the party. And I think time's out for him. He's going to try those.
Oh, no!
With the gravity field!